Do you think the idea of white supremacy was a factor in the 2016 election?
I do. I think it was an essential factor. I don't think it's a mistake that, as I outlined, and as you said in the epilogue, the first white president, I don't think it was a mistake that Donald Trump began his political career in birtherism, in the idea that our first black president was not actually a legitimate citizen and thus not a legitimate president. I don't think it was a mistake that large portions of the opposition party, of the Republican Party at that time, believed that, that the base actually believed that, that the leadership spent much of his time winking and nodding. I think it's connected to Newt Gingrich when he was running for president in the primaries in 2012, labeling Barack Obama a food stamp president. I think it's, you know, connected to the congressman from South Carolina who stood up and yelled, "You lie," as Barack Obama was talking. I think it's all linked.
During the State of the Union address.
Yes. I think it's all linked together, actually.
Barack Obama.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me how you feel about him, what you think of him, what impact he had on you.
I think he's one of the smartest people I've ever met. I can recall being in off-the-record briefings and watching a roundtable of reporters ask him questions ranging from everything from taxes to the environment to foreign policy, and him being able to offer answers to those questions in considerable depth. It was remarkable. It was really, really remarkable. I think he was, in terms of becoming the first black president, the perfect person at the perfect time. I don't think there are many other Barack Obamas. I don't think there are many other African Americans who could navigate the straits that he navigated in order to become president.
But does he have a different attitude about white America than you do?
Probably, yeah.
Well, not probably. I mean, you make this point rather strongly.
Yeah, I would say so.
He was raised by, his mother was white. He knew white people. He didn't view them harshly.
No, he didn't. But see, more importantly than that, because there are people who...
But you make people, that point, that he grew up...
I do, but more. I think even more important than him actually having white family, because that's not particularly new in African-American history. He had white family that actually embraced him as a black person. Like, that wasn't a problem within. In fact, it was, I don't want to say. Well, he argued that his grandfather actually fetishized it a little bit. He said it. But if anything, it was, towards the positive end. You know, it was a kind of naivete. But he didn't feel, he wasn't made to feel any type of way, any type of negative way about the fact of being black. On the contrary, his family in many ways was a conduit to the African-American experience, to African-American culture, politics, his mom, his dad taking him to jazz clubs.
So
that's a very different thing.
To the black culture.
Right. I have not encountered a story like that. I've encountered stories of black people with a white parent, but not one in which the white parent is that, frankly, that white family is that loving.
And wanted to make sure he understood and appreciated, the
being black
culture.
Yeah. That is different.
But do you also believe that it in a sense, restrained him? Or in some way, because his experience had been different, so mm-hmm. that he didn't want to be talking about race all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I think most black people don't want to be talking about race all the time, though. I mean, I have my own suite of curiosities that I would love to be sitting here talking to you about now.
But you wrote the book.
I did write the book. I think the difference is...
The book is the subject.
Yes, the book is the subject. I think the difference, Charlie, is not so much, because I think actually he spent a lot of time thinking and talking about race. I think the difference with him was that, again, when, white people literally are your family, when you, as he would say, when you go to Iowa and you see people and they remind you of your grandparents, and that's a positive thing to you. That's a positive thing. That signals acceptance to you.
Yeah.
It's a very, very different relationship.
Did he change over the 8 years? Mm. Did he change?
Mm. I don't know, because I didn't start really interacting with him until 2011, 2012.
Well, that's 3 years into the presidency.
Yeah. What I know, just from his own testimony, and talking to him, he and the office probably underestimated the kind of opposition that they were going to face. They thought that they would have.
And was that because he was black?
Was the opposition because he was black? That was part of it, but it's more complicated than that. I think it was because...
Understand the complexity.
Okay. It wasn't just that he was a black president. It was that he was a representative of the Democratic Party where the vast majority of black people are represented, which is a very, very different thing. For instance, people often say, well, Bill Clinton also got, a lot of resistance. But parties represent people. If you go to the South, for instance, today, the Republican Party is virtually entirely a white party at the local level. And so Barack Obama wasn't just a black politician. It wasn't just a matter of them looking at him as a black person. It was whose interests he represented and whose interests they represented. So, yeah, that was a factor.
But did you grow over those 8 years? I mean, did you change at all?
Yeah, a lot.
How did you change?
I mean, I didn't believe in reparations when it started.
You learned that from all the Civil War reading? Is that what turned
you? Civil War reading was a gateway to everything else.
1,200 books you read on the Civil War?
Here's the thing. In terms of an ambassador, Barack Obama was like the best we had, by which I mean—
Ambassador from whom to whom?
To Black America, to the rest of the country.
Right.
By the standards of which, you know, America tends to hold people, middle class values, et cetera, I mean, he was like, you know, like a character out of the Brady Bunch or something. You know, him, you know, erect, Ivy League lawyer, you know, beautiful, attractive wife, also an Ivy League lawyer.
Editor of the Law Review.
Editor of the Law Review, beautiful children, dog named Bo. I mean, it was just you know, miraculous representative.
It's what Hollywood would have done if they made the movie.
Exactly. And then to see half of a political party, you know, see Donald Trump have to force this guy to actually show out his birth certificate. You see that and you say, okay, something deep is going on here. Mm-hmm. Something profound, and that, you know, spurred me on onto my search, which probably radicalized me a little bit and pushed
radicalized
me.
Radicalized
you? Yeah, I think so. I think I was a pretty standard issue left liberal at the beginning. I don't think I really believed in, you know, race conscious policy, for instance. I mean, if I did, I was kind of hazy.
You believe
on
in identity politics?
I think all politics is identity politics. I don't think you can get away
more
from
it. More than economic politics?
I don't think they're contrary to each other. I don't think you can talk about. I don't think in America people ever talk about one without talking about the other.
Exactly.
They may not spell it out that way, but I think if you get down to brass tacks, they almost.
If you talk about identity politics, you're talking about economic.
I mean, if you talk about social security.
You're talking about economic results.
Yeah, but I mean, if you say, you know, I'm going to fight and I'm going to preserve Medicare and Social Security. Well, you're talking about a particular group of people, right? You know, an age bracket of people who have the ability to access those benefits. You are necessarily speaking to an identity, you know. You clearly are not speaking to 25-year-olds. That's not who you're making your pitch to. And so I think it's, you know, I think it's true across the board. I don't know a politics that can get away from identity.
This is what you say. The central thread of this book is eight articles written during the 8 years of the first black president, a period of good Negro government. Let's talk about what that is. Mm-hmm. That's the first chapter.
Mm-hmm. The title is taken from a declaration made by a congressman by the name of Thomas Miller in 1895. Thomas Miller was a congressman in the era of Reconstruction, right after the Civil War. He served with a number of legislators who had either been, you know, free black people in advance of the Civil War or were in fact enslaved. And in 1895, he is at the South Carolina Constitutional Convention, where they are effectively disenfranchising blacks and just taking, you know, the rights of black people away in the state of South Carolina. And he can't understand why they would do this. And he says, we were 8 years in power. And in our time, we basically reconstructed the entire state. And in response to that, the great historian and activist and writer W.E.B. Du Bois said that Miller made a critical error. He was making an argument for good Negro government, that Negroes had been good governing the state of South Carolina. And Du Bois says what he failed to understand was what South Carolina feared more than bad Negro government was actually good Negro government, that the fact that they had been so successful put the lie to white supremacy. And I think that's a theme that you can trace all the way up till today.
Didn't Barack Obama put the lie to racism, too?
Yes, and I think that was the problem. That's exactly it. And
that was the problem,
yes,
and that is the reason, because he put the lie to racism.
Yeah.
Because he was so superbly talented.
All of the things I outlined for you, like when I was talking about him being a great ambassador, this idea of, you know, looking like something out of the Brady Bunch, it countered the idea of what black people are. It countered the stereotype. And I think that, in fact, was actually quite upsetting, because these stereotypes of black people are at the root of the belief system behind the actual policies of white supremacy. And so I think that explains a lot of...
So you're saying those people looked at Barack Obama, they would have, if they had looked at Barack Obama in a way that measured their own expectation, you know, they would not have had the necessary need to to rebel
they
against
him. As a human. There's a kind of like a long history of this. Like if you look at the history of lynchings and race riots in this country, often the places that are attacked are middle class, quote unquote, well-to-do black areas because they stand in violation of the very idea of white supremacy. They offend the hierarchy. And Barack Obama was very much in the same sort of
offending
school.
The hierarchy.
Yes, yes. He wasn't black in anybody's boots. He wasn't below. You know, he was, as so many people said, he gave evidence to the idea that my child could be president. Well, there are other people on the side of that equation who also take evidence of something else. And I think that explains a lot about, you know, where our politics are right now.
What was the expression that Martin Luther King said that the arc bends towards justice?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You believe that?
No.
You don't?
No. As I've said before, I think it bends towards chaos. And chaos means you don't know. Could be good, could be bad. We'll see. I hope for good, you know, but you just don't know. You just don't know.